We hope you and your family are enjoying back-to-school season. Visit queenslibrary.org to see all of our back-to-school programs and giveaways, and to read our back-to-school guide with helpful information about family communication, college readiness, and other topics related to health, happiness, and success during the upcoming school year. Every year, Hispanic Heritage Month celebrates the achievements of Hispanic Americans, the contributions of Hispanic people to our country, and the fact that there is no American culture without Hispanic culture. Join us for our virtual and in-person programs and enjoy our special book lists for all ages. Visit queenslibrary.org to learn more. It's Library Card Sign-Up Month. A Queens Public Library card is your passport to more than 5.5 million books, movies, and other media, over 40,000 classes and events per year, more than 5,000 computer workstations all across Queens, and so much more. Discover everything that's free with a library card. Visit our website or your local library to apply for your QPL card.
Welcome to Queens Public Library's talk with Chun Han Wong, author of Party of One, The Rise of Xi Jinping and China's Superpower Future, and Ian Johnson, a senior fellow for China Studies at the Council on Foreign Relations and a Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist who covered China for The Wall Street Journal and The New York Times. Evan Osnos, author of Age of Ambition, Chasing Fortune, Truth, and Faith in the New China, stated, "More than a decade into the era of Xi Jinping, readers ask, why are there so few penetrating books on China's leader? The answer is that Communist Party deems even Xi's birthday too sensitive to disclose. But now the skilled and energetic journalist Chun Han Wong has drawn on an impressive range of reporting and sources to craft superb, readable, illuminating portrait of the man and his times, a must-read for China veterans and amateurs alike. From Kirkus Reviews, a respected journalist combines history, headlines, and a personal reflection in a careful analysis of China's leader for life, a penetrating and timely unraveling of the personality and impact of a strong man president. Bonnie Glazer, Managing Director, Indo-Pacific Program, German Marshall Fund of the U.S., wrote, Chun Han Wong does a masterful job of scrutinizing Xi Jinping's impact on China and placing Xi's first 10 years in power in the context of the broader arc of China's history. Through extensive research and interviews with PRC citizens from all walks of life, he reveals in vivid detail the ways in which Xi Jinping's policies have altered China's evolutionary path, affected the lives of its people, and shaped China's relations with the rest of the world. Party of One brims with insights into the multitude of contradictions that make up Xi's China. It's a captivating read for anyone seeking to more deeply understand China in the Xi Jinping era. Hi, I'm Brian Alessandro. I have written for Interview Magazine, Newsday, Pank, Huffington Post, Lambda Literary, The Gay and Lesbian Review, and have recently co-adapted Edmund White's A Boy's Own Story into a graphic novel for Top Shelf Productions. Additionally, I edited Fever Spores, co-edited Fever Spores, The Queer Reclamation of William S. Burroughs, an anthology of essays and interviews about Burroughs for Rebel Satori Press. I'm also the co-founder and editor-in-chief of the literary journal The New Engagement. My first novel, The Unmentionable Mon, was published in 2015 by Cairn Press, and my first feature film, Afghan Hound, was produced by Marie Media in 2011. It is currently streaming on Plex, Tubi, and Amazon. My new novel, Performer Non Grata, was released in April by Rebel Satori Press. Culture Connection, curated by Daniel Zaleski and now in its 10th year at the Queens Public Library, is proud to present international artists from emerging talent to award-winning masters. These disciplines include music, theater, author talks, and film. Now expanding into a virtual format, Culture Connection is currently reaching a global audience. Chun Han Wong has covered China for the Wall Street Journal since 2014. He was part of a team of reporters named as Pulitzer Prize finalists for their coverage of China's autocratic turn under Xi Jinping. As a journal correspondent in Beijing and Hong Kong, Wong has written widely on subjects spanning elite politics, Communist Party doctrine, human and labor rights, and defense and diplomatic affairs. Born and raised in Singapore, Wong is a native speaker of English and Mandarin Chinese. He studied international history at the London School of Economics, where he graduated with first-class honors and won the Derby Bryce Prize. Ian Johnson is a Canadian-born American writer and independent scholar known for his longtime reporting on a series of books on China and Germany. Johnson writes regularly for the New York Times Review of Books, the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal. Johnson won the 2001 Pulitzer for his coverage in the Wall Street Journal on the persecution of Falun Gong practitioners in China. His reporting from China was also honored in 2001 by the Overseas Press Club and the Society of Professional Journalists. In 2017, he won Stanford University's Shorenstein Prize for his body of work covering Asia. In 2019, he won the American Academy of Religion's Best In-Depth News Writing Award. Thank you so much for joining us, Chun and Ian. And Chun is joining us from Singapore, where it is already Saturday morning. So thank you for getting up so early for us on a weekend, Chun.
No problem. Great to be on the show.
Like, that's wonderful having you both here. Before we begin, I'd like to say a few words about my personal experiences. I spent a few months in China in 2011, mainly Beijing and Shenzhou and Chengdu, as well as Tibet for a short while, working for a Chinese company that prepared students for the verbal section of the SAT, as well as college admissions essays and university in America. I also befriended several American journalists for the New York Times and the New Yorker while there. Hu Jintao was president at the time, and there was a fair amount of discussion in my circles about Xi Jinping, who would become president 2 years later in 2013. And so much of what has happened since I was there, as chronicled in your book, has been alarming, but not completely unexpected. We're doing things a little bit different this week, given Ian's extensive experience in and knowledge of China. This interview will be primarily between Chun and Ian, and I will periodically interject with a few questions of my own. And I will also let you both know when it is time for audience questions during the last 10 minutes or so of the program. So Ian, please take it away.
Yeah, well, thank you for hosting this talk. It's really an honor to be able to host Chun Han with his new book, Party of One, which is one of the very few insightful looks at the life of, or really the best so far biography of Xi Jinping by far. And I'm not saying that to be polite. It's really a well-researched book with tons of footnotes, which you don't have to read, but which are all there because it's a densely reported, very difficult, I think, to report kind of book. And maybe that's my first question for you, Chun Han. You worked in China from 2014 to 2019. 2014 was just after Xi Jinping took power in late 2012. And 2019 was just before the COVID lockdown, when basically the country went into some sort of off and on rolling lockdowns for 3 years. And so you were there at this sort of high Xi Jinping era, when he was consolidating his power and then passed the law that made him, allowed him to become leader for life. So this was sort of a really crucial, important period. There were many things, though, you could have reported on in China that would have been a lot easier than elite politics and Xi Jinping. Why did you choose this? And what was the kind of research that you did? Maybe why did you choose to report on this? And when did you know you wanted to write a book on Xi Jinping? Maybe you just walk us through that.
Sure. So I moved to Beijing from Singapore in 2014. At the time, I was actually covering, you know, Singapore, Southeast Asia, politics, business, economics, quite a wide range of topics. And at the time, the Beijing bureau chief for the Wall Street Journal, Charles Tetzler, he saw some of my coverage in Singapore. A couple of the stories involved Chinese migrants in Singapore. So he sort of sensed that, okay, this guy, you know, seems to know what he's doing and has an interest in covering China-related issues. So he said, you know, would you like to move to Beijing? And, you know, it's like, how do you say no to that? You know, covering the world's second largest economy and arguably going to become, if not already, the world's most consequential nation. And I said yes. Moved to Beijing in 2014. And initially, I didn't cover elite politics. Initially, I was more looking at, you know, you just start in China, you should have a way to, like, you know, start growing to the job and learn about the country. So I was initially assigned to cover labor issues. So actually, I was writing about, you know, industrial unrest, labor actions, and sort of government policy on labor affairs. So I was writing things about strikes, industrial action in Guangzhou, Guangdong, you know, in the southern part of China, where there's a lot of, you know, it's a major manufacturing hub, and the workers there are more attuned to, you know, sort of organizing among themselves. And going on strikes to seek better treatment. So that was actually my initial coverage area, covering things like that. But through there, you know, you get exposure to the country, you learn, you talk to ordinary people, you talk to activists, you talk to academics. And, you know, in China, nothing is really divorced from politics. You know, Communist Party is in charge. Their priorities shape virtually every facet of the society. So from there, you know, slowly you learn more about how the political system works. And at the time, one of my colleagues was transitioning away from elite politics, Jeremy Page, I'm sure you know who he is. He was the guy who covered one of the biggest political scandals in China in the past decade, you know, basically the downfall of one of the most senior officials in China at the time, Bo Xilai. And he was moving on to covering more, you know, defense and diplomatic affairs. And my boss was like, why don't you, you know, step up and try to cover elite politics? And that's how I actually got started. And it was not easy, you know, it's as an, although I can speak the language, you know, it's still a lot of things they have to learn. You know, you have to come to terms with Chinese history. I did study history, so that was a big help. You know, I already knew a lot of, you know, basic information, but you still had to work and, you know, read actual like dense historical text and keep up to date with daily news reporting and read Chinese state media, because I think that is one of the big windows into how the party functions. It is a huge party. Right now it's 97 million people. They have to talk to themselves, and one big avenue is through state media. And reading that kind of stuff gives you a sense of like, what is the vocabulary the Communist Party uses to talk to itself? You know, what are the priorities? What do they care about? What do they want to do? A lot of that actually comes through in the state media coverage. So that became like an important way to learn. And obviously from there, you try to build sources, talk to people who actually know a bit more things behind the door, behind closed doors. And from there, build out my expertise in this area.
When did you know you wanted to write a bio of Xi Jinping?
So actually, I'm sure you know Richard McGregor, a former Financial Times bureau chief in Beijing. He has a very good book known as The Party, which is published in 2010. And it's basically, at the time, you know, Xi Jinping hadn't taken power yet. So it's essentially sort of a primer for people trying to understand China and Chinese politics. Of essentially a previous era under Hu Jintao. And it was very good. It basically covered all the major facets of Communist Party governance in China. But, you know, when I moved to Beijing, you know, I was covering Chinese politics, people started asking me, like, so what's a good book to read if you want to learn what's going on in China? And for a long time, I would recommend The Party. But as the Xi Jinping era rolled on, you start to realize, actually, quite a few of the things that The Party described, Richard McGregor, although at the time when he published it, it was very, you know, it was accurate, it was up to date. But as Xi Jinping started to implement his vision, you realize a lot of the things that he described in that book were no longer the reality. Things have moved on. One thing that, you know, the party described, for example, is this idea that the party, the Communist Party, is this sort of deep force behind the shadows. They sort of put themselves behind this facade of, you know, government bureaucracy and all these other agencies that front their policymaking and front their policy implementation. But they're content to control, you know, personnel, control like the higher level policymaking and let the government do implementation. They don't necessarily shout, you know, in your face that the party's in charge. Xi Jinping, one of the things he's done since taking power, as you know, he's declared that the party leads everything. Essentially, the party is front and center in Chinese public life. It dominates virtually every public institution. You know, today officials would list their party titles before their professional titles, which is something that wasn't the case, you know, before Xi Jinping took power, at least in the reform eras, you know, since Mao Zedong's death. So a lot of the things that were described in Richard McGregor's book, you know, simply became out of date. And I thought, perhaps there's space, there's a gap in the market for someone to write a book that actually describes how China has changed since Xi Jinping took power. And I thought, well, if no one else is doing it, maybe I could try. And, you know, I talked to friends and eventually built out a thesis and wrote a proposal and got along the process. And now we have the book out, and I hope people are finding it useful and educational about what's going on.
You mentioned the role of history, and I know that's something Brian is interested in. Brian, you had a question related to that. Why don't you jump in?
Thank you, Ian. Yeah, and Chun-Han, it's a little bit broad, so forgive me. See if you can sort of simplify it as best you can. Chinese history and culture and all of its dynasties and revolutions and transformations are really quite complex. Can you draw a simplified line from the many centuries that engendered the collapse of the last dynasty, the Qing, and the rise of Mao and communism in 1949, and then Xi Jinping today? In other words, can you provide a historical context for what engendered Xi Jinping's rise?
I think it would be a bit too ambitious to try to attempt to draw a direct line between Xi Jinping's ascension to power and anything beyond, say, the Mao era, because before that, you know, a lot of things are contingent. You know, as if you study history, like you start to realize like a lot of things could have turned out quite differently without going to counterfactuals too much. But in terms of where I would say you can see a more clear relationship between recent or modern Chinese history and Xi Jinping's emergence as the PRC leader today and what he's done, I think you, first of all, you have to look back to the Mao era. Mao Zedong, the founder of the PRC, and what happened during his, you know, roughly three decades in charge of the country. Obviously, the most famous thing that happened during his time was the Cultural Revolution, and Xi Jinping grew up during that period. For people who haven't read the book, Xi Jinping was born in 1953. The People's Republic was barely 4 years old. Mm-hmm. And within, you know, he grew up actually in relative comfort as a son of a revolutionary elder and a senior government official. His father, Xi Zhongxun, was actually a propaganda minister under Mao when Xi Jinping was born. And, you know, that meant that you had access to good schools, you know, you live in a courtyard home in Beijing, you had relatively good conditions, you know, comparatively luxurious to most people in the country. And that was sort of this bubble of comfort that Xi Jinping experienced when he grew up. But then by 1962, his father was purged, you know, for allegedly supporting a book that featured a character that was modeled after an official who was seen as betraying Mao. So this convoluted, you know, coup that was cast upon his father, basically accusing him of being anti-party, that brought him into disgrace, and Xi Jinping's role essentially sort of fell apart. You know, from being a member of the respected elite, you became quote unquote a black gang child, a son of a disgraced official. That shook up his worldview, shook up his, you know, his entire lived experience. And then the Cultural Revolution happened 4 years later in 1966. That was essentially, you know, earth-shattering moment for many Chinese people, brought the country into turmoil. Xi Jinping grew up during that tumultuous period, you know, went through a lot of hardships. And you could say that you could quite plausibly draw a line between that experience and what he has done today. You know, the Xi Jinping associate we see today in China is one of that's sort of defined by this idea of control. You know, the party has to be in absolute control of every facet of society, every facet of governance, to keep things in place and keep things stable. And you could say in some ways that is an instinct, at least for Xi Jinping personally, that was a very clear personal experience that he went through. A decade of huge chaos, more than a decade for him personally, where, you know, China was in turmoil, and he definitely was shaped by that experience, like, I have to make sure this never happens in China again. So I think you can draw a line between that and what he has come to do. More recently, in terms of how Xi Jinping actually came to power and what animated him in, you know, the past decade after he became leader, I think you also could look at the Hu Jintao period, which is when Hu Jintao was a paramount leader from 2002 to 2012. Mm-hmm. In that period, you know, China became the world's second largest economy. You had double-digit economic growth every year on average. You know, China grew, you know, by material measures. China was prospering, things were going great. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, there are all these underlying social tensions that were building up. You had all these problems of perhaps, you know, ineffective governance and policy gridlock at the center. You're not dealing with things like, you know, ordinary people's welfare. There was huge income inequality. You had a lot of the growth was essentially backed by sort of wanton government officials, you know, they're doing whatever they wanted at local level. You know, they would essentially grab seized land from farmers, you know, they would run roughshod over rule of law. And this is causing a lot of problems. You know, there were a lot of industrial unrest, social unrest, people protesting over land grabs. And crime rates were going up. So there was this, even though outwardly there was China's projecting this image of prosperity and, you know, ascendancy, there were a lot of internal problems simmering. And Xi Jinping himself actually told then Vice President Joseph Biden when he was visiting China in 2011 that China was facing a lot of internal problems and we needed this sort of strong centralized leadership to exert control and prevent sort of these mounting social forces from tearing the country apart. And as it turned out, Xi Jinping, once he took power, proceeded to make himself that centralizing force, reorganize the party and by extension the country around his own authority. And I think if you look at the things he went through, look at the things that he was reacting to just before he took power, I think we can definitely draw a connection.
Fascinating, really. Can you talk to us a little bit about Xi's wife, Peng Liwan? She was very famous in China when they met and married, right? She was an opera singer.
Yes, she was a folk singer. In some ways, you could say she still is. I mean, I don't think you ever stop being a singer. But she was also a member of the People's Liberation Army, which meant that, you know, she actually, her job at the time was in the 80s, was to entertain the troops. But she really became famous because she performed in this thing called the Chun, which is China Central Television's annual Lunar New Year gala. You know, she performed a popular song and that really made her name. But, you know, she, at the time, she was also doing things like traveling to the Sino-Vietnamese border in the 80s and entertaining the troops stationed there. And at the time, that was not actually a very safe thing to do because there were still border skirmishes happening between China and Vietnam. You know, and in fact, there's a famous photograph of her performing for the troops on Tiananmen Square in 1989 after the crackdown on the student-led protest there. So that was sort of a job at the time. Xi Jinping and Peng Yuan actually met in 1986. They got married in 1987. And Peng was Xi's second wife. So she had a previous wife who is the daughter of the China's ambassador to the UK, but they got divorced. And Xi Jinping was introduced to Peng Liyuan in 86 through friends. And famously, their first interaction, their first, you know, meeting was when, you know, Peng Liyuan was actually like a bit wary, you know, but she was impressed by the fact that Xi Jinping was not like most other people who tried to court her. You know, a lot of people would like, you know, gush over her and things like that. But Xi Jinping was actually sort of this very almost academic in the way he asked, you know, questions of Peng Liyuan. Like, so what are some singing techniques? You know, mm-hmm. Why don't other people, you know, go into, you know, essentially talk, gush over her celebrity status and all that kind of stuff. But Xi Jinping actually asked very studious questions. And
she, you know, he appealed to her craft.
Yeah, exactly. But like, Peng Liyuan actually became an interesting personality because the last Chinese leader, before Peng Liyuan, the last Chinese leader to have a sort of famous wife and a larger-than-life wife is Mao Zedong's wife, Jiang Qing, his fourth wife. And that was not a good memory for many Chinese people. In fact, she's arguably one of the most hated figures in modern Chinese history because she's seen as leading the worst excesses of the Cultural Revolution. She was the number one of the so-called Gang of Four, the four officials who sort of were pulling the most strings and trying to orchestrate the worst purges during the Cultural Revolution in Mao's name. So Jiang Qing sort of gave first ladies a bad name in the PRC context. And most first ladies after her were very publicity shy. Like they sort of don't really appear in public. They do accompany their spouses on diplomatic trips, but they don't try to get much attention. They're just sort of there. They attend the spousal program quietly, and you don't really hear much from them. Whereas Peng Liyuan actually was more famous than Xi. The joke among some Chinese people when Xi Jinping became heir apparent in 2007 was that, who's Xi Jinping? Oh, he's Peng Liyuan's husband. Everyone knew who she was, but far fewer people knew who Xi Jinping was. Mm-hmm. So that is the thing. And in some ways, it became an asset because it gave him star power. It gave him this sense of glitz and glamour. Like, you know, here's a famous wife, you know. You know, it's sort of like a marker of success in a way to have like a, you know, successful wife. And she also became like a goodwill ambassador for the World Health Organization. She took on charitable causes. And in the early years of Xi Jinping's reign, she actually was quite high profile. She would accompany him on diplomatic trips and, you know, dress really nicely. You know, she became sort of a fashion icon. She brought star power. You know, people would like look at, you know, what she wore and like what phone she used and things like that. But that sort of faded in more recent years as Xi Jinping decided to put the center of attention more on himself. Peng Liyuan is still around. She's still very visible, but not as visible as she was in the early years of Xi Jinping's presidency.
Interesting. Thank you.
You know, you were mentioning when they got married, and he was a junior official at that time. And when I was a reporter in China, I went to Zhengding, which is the city south of Beijing, which mm-hmm. was his first posting outside of Beijing after the Cultural mm-hmm. Revolution, where he was a junior official, really like a county, head of a county, and then he moved on to Fujian and so on. I wonder, during that time out in the provinces, did he have a remarkable career? Was he sort of a rising star? And could people have predicted, say, you know, 15, 20 years ago, I'll say, that this guy is going to be the next leader of China in the way that one might look at a U.S. politician, a governor or something, and say, well, that person's a rising star? Or did he have more of a low-key background?
He was definitely had some positive appraisal. So he was more low-key compared to some of his peers. I can get into that a bit later. But like, he also had good reviews from his peers, as in his direct colleagues in the jobs that he was doing early in his career. He had a good reputation for being very hardworking and conscientious, you know, could maintain good international relationships with his colleagues and superiors, could, you know, strike a good rapport with ordinary people. And in fact, in the 1980s, when he was still at Zhengding, at the time, Deng Xiaoping was trying to encourage ways to promote young, promising officials faster up the hierarchy, because the party had just come off the Cultural Revolution, the internal bureaucracy was shattered. You know, a lot of the established officials were older and, you know, getting advanced in age and less energetic. And Deng Xiaoping decided, I need to rejuvenate the party, bring in fresh young blood. And he sent out, you know, he tasked the organization department, which is essentially the party's HR department, to go and find, you know, identify promising people and potentially fast track them into higher positions. And so one of these assessors who I actually interviewed when I was in Beijing, and he did write a book about his career as well. And he describes, you know, Xi Jinping, he actually met Xi Jinping in the 80s when he was doing this evaluation mission. And he, at the time, he talked to a lot of his, Xi Jinping's peers, and, you know, he came away with a very good impression of him. Like, this is a guy, despite his sort of privileged background as a senior official's son, you know, he still carried himself well. He was hardworking. He did the right things, you know, despite some, you know, complaints from local officials who maybe sort of like jealous of him being like a parachuted in to Zhengding and, you know, running the show. They more or less came away with a good impression of this guy. And he was sort of identified as one of those officials worthy of a promotion and potential fast track into higher ranks of the party. But at the same time, his early career was also, you know, marked by some less savory incidents. If you look at his time in, for example, Fujian, the most famous incident that happened then was the 1999 scandal, Yuanhua smuggling ring, which was exposed at that time. This hundreds of millions of dollars, perhaps billions, were smuggled in terms of various consumer goods that using connections with police and the military. And that happened in Fujian. And when Xi Jinping was at the time a senior provincial leader, he himself was not directly implicated, but a lot of the people around him were taken down in connection to this scandal. He became governor as this scandal was unfolding, and he sort of was tasked with like the political cleanup. So he managed to escape direct personal damage from this episode, and he, in some cases, came away deepening his relationships with important patrons. For example, Jia Qingling, who's the Fujian party boss at the time, his wife was actually rumored to be involved in the smuggling ring, and Xi Jinping came out to say, there's absolutely no proof and no that she definitely wasn't involved in the smuggling. Like, he came out to defend his boss's spouse. You know, that sort of thing obviously wins you points with your bosses. And this sort of basically, I think in his early career, you know, he wasn't particularly outstanding. He definitely had his moments where his performances won the attention of superiors in Beijing and in the provinces he was in. But there were also episodes that suggested that, you know, there were problems around him, whether it's of his doing or his colleagues doing, it's not very clear, but it's not as if he had this like glowing resume that was like free of blemishes. He had definitely experienced some problems during his career, but nothing that actually turned out to be that damaging to his personal reputation. So in the end, you know, he was able to, I think, survive and also make the right connections. I was mentioning earlier, compared to some of his peers at the time who also were seen as particularly promising. So if you think about another princeling, another son of a revolutionary elder, Bo Xilai, whose father was one of the so-called eight elders of the party, eight most powerful officials after Mao Zedong died. Bo Xilai was far more gregarious. You know, he's this very charismatic, well-spoken, you know, if you met him, I never met him personally. I've seen videos of him speaking, you know, when you watch him do his thing, like he's easily the best retail politician in China in the post-Mao era, probably. And there's huge contrast to Xi Jinping. Xi Jinping was very good at glad-handing like fellow party officials, party elders, good at building those relationships. Bo Xilai was far more at home, you know, just walking the ground and talking to normal people and charming them. And this guy drew attention to himself. He did a lot of things that self-promotional stuff. And that actually pissed some people off, you know, in Beijing. Like, this guy is not doing things the way we would like. And it actually caused rifts, you know, caused a lot of tension between him and other people upper ranks of the party. So in some ways, you could say that actually hindered him, because that eventually, you could say, made him a lot of enemies, and that didn't help when he came into political trouble in 2012 and Bo Xilai was taken down. Whereas Xi Jinping sort of, you know, kept it cool. He was not particularly outstanding, but at the same time, he did nothing to offend people. He was inoffensive. He made friends with everybody. Everyone thought like Xi Jinping was sort of their guy in a way. He never struck a strong position on issues that would mark him out as a, you know, say someone on the left or someone on the right within the party. He always played this middle road that made him, you know, amenable to various positions and various views in the party. And I think that really helped him, you know, in terms of getting himself established and rise through the ranks of the party.
So he gets appointed in 2007 to be the heir apparent. 2012, he takes over and initiates his crackdown. This leads to something that I think Brian is interested in. You have an interesting question here on the crackdown on education and stuff like that. Maybe you want to talk about that.
Yeah, thanks, Ian. So, you know, the Chinese company that I alluded to earlier that I worked for in 2011 felt very much like a blend of a state-funded NGO and a private corporation, and was aimed at helping Chinese students learn English and get into top American colleges. Most of my pupils wrote admissions essays about learning from America to make China stronger, and all had a real sense of social service. I know the industry in China is, or was, upwards of $100 billion. Can you discuss how Xi Jinping has affected its development?
I think in terms of student exchanges and academic exchanges between the US and China, that has definitely taken a big hit in recent years, especially during the pandemic, when essentially China closed its borders, made it really difficult for people trying to leave the country. And at the same time, you know, since the Trump administration took power, we've seen this increasing suspicion and hostility towards China. And that has been reflected in how, you know, Chinese academics, Chinese students are treated on campuses in the US. And that also has this reputational effect for a lot of would-be Chinese students who might have considered going to the US and they realize that actually it's not such a welcoming environment. Perhaps you can consider going to other countries like the UK, Canada, Australia. So there's different factors that sort of combined, I think, in the last few years that made it less attractive. It's not to say like, you know, there's still lots of Chinese students studying in America. And it is still in some, I think many campuses, probably Chinese students account for the biggest group of foreign students in those universities. But I think relative to where things could have been before the pandemic, before Xi Jinping, really, you know, under him, US-China relations deteriorating, it's definitely fallen short of what things could have become. I'm not sure what the current figures are, but as an indication of this, I think in the first half of 2022, the number of US student visas issued to Chinese nationals fell by more than 50% compared to 2019. So that is a pretty sharp decline. And I'm not sure you could ever really recover to pre-COVID levels. Maybe you could, but that would take time. But the interesting thing here is also to for people who are maybe not as familiar with Xi Jinping, and in fact, something that other senior Chinese leaders do, which is send their children to the US to study. So Xi Jinping's only child, his daughter, actually studied at Harvard in the early 2010s. And a lot of other senior Chinese officials also send their children to the US.
Yes.
And, you know, this is obviously, you know, well before the current, you know, developments in terms of bilateral relations. But there was a period of time where it was completely fine, even for the most senior Chinese officials, to send their children to the United States to study. And now it's unthinkable. You know, you couldn't imagine someone saying, oh, I could send my child to Beida or Tsinghua, you know, most prestigious university in China, but no, I'm going to send him to Harvard or Yale. Like, that's simply unthinkable now.
Oh, interesting. I have two more questions, Ian. I'll get through those quickly, and then the rest of the hour is yours. Chun Han, you wrote that the Communist Party has punished 4.6 million people in the decades since Xi took power. Can you discuss this idea of red bloodlines, and particularly Xi's relationship with them and how they were spared persecution?
Mm-hmm. So, as mentioned earlier, Xi Jinping is a princeling, which is this term that, you know, people within the party and outside describe descendants of elite party officials and revolutionary elders. So Xi Jinping himself is part of the red bloodline. You know, his father, you know, fought against the nationalists, fought against the Japanese, you know, was essentially a senior official during the early years of the People's Republic. So he's part of that group. You know, a lot of his friends are from that group. I've spoken to one of his friends whose father was close friends with Xi's father. And, you know, they all knew each other. And they're all sort of like acquainted and walked within similar circles. Some went into politics, some did not, some went into business. But a lot of them still hang out. And you can see their photos floating online and in some like memoirs and books where you can find Xi Jinping basically posing in a group photograph with other famous descendants of party officials. Like they have annual gatherings, they are friends. So in terms of the corruption crackdown, we've seen that it's not that these people weren't targeted. I think Xi Jinping is quite selective in terms of who he targets within, you know, his peer group among princelings. So, you know, as you mentioned, 4.6 million people in the first 10 years of Xi Jinping's rule that have been punished by the Communist Party's disciplinary agency is essentially a tactic to, you know, there are two elements of this. One is to fight corruption, which is definitely an existential problem for the party. But obviously, there is a huge element of political consolidation. The corruption campaign is a way to get rid of rivals. It is a way to instill fear in the bureaucracy to get people to obey you. You know, if officials are fearful of you, you know, you can exert your influence more effectively that way. At least that's how she saw it. But there are certain people that somehow remain untouchable. There were obviously princelings or famous or senior officials who were taken down in the anti-corruption campaign, but there are also others who you could say, hang on, you know, the popular perception of these people is that they are irretrievably corrupt, yet somehow they survive. They you may not hear much from them, but you know, the fact that nothing happened to them suggests that, you know, Xi Jinping is not actually absolute in how it goes after corruption. And that is understandable from a political perspective in the sense that, you know, you can't possibly take on everybody. You need to have friends. You need to have people you can rely on to support you. You can't go after every corrupt element in the party. Otherwise, you make everyone so fearful of their own well-being, they might unite to bring you down. So it is power politics. It is, you know, palace intrigue. There are definitely, this is a degree of consideration that factors into Xi's thinking and deciding who can I take down, how should I take them down. In fact, some of the people who Xi has gone after, he doesn't go after the person directly himself. What he does is he sort of neutralizes this potential rival or potential threat by taking down people below this guy. Like, for example, Wang Qishan, as I write about in the book, in fact, a story just last year, which is Wang Qishan is one of Xi Jinping's, you know, close friends. Like they've known each other since the Cultural Revolution. They've been colleagues. They worked together back then in the 80s. And more recently, when Xi Jinping took power the first term, his first 5 years as paramount leader, Wang Qishan was running the anti-corruption campaign. He ran the Communist Party's disciplinary agency. And you wouldn't give that job to just anybody. You would give it to someone you really trust to exercise this power in your name. Yet, after Wang Qishan retired in 2017, we started to see, you know, subtle movements that suggest that, you know, Xi Jinping is trying to make sure Wang Qishan can't even pose some sort of latent threat to him. Hmm. One of his Wang Qishan's closest aides in his earlier career was taken down for corruption. Other people around him sort of, you know, disappeared and were detained briefly, not necessarily charged with anything, but they were investigated and sort of like had a shot fired across their bowels. So all these small gestures suggest that, you know, Xi Jinping is sort of dismantling or neutralizing the political networks for people who could pose sort of an alternate power center to him. And whether, you know, how he goes about this, I think, is informed by the idea that, okay, I have to be very strategic in who to target. You know, I cannot go after certain people for fear of, you know, that blowing back in my face. So I think his relationships with princelings is this very subtle and dynamic thing that we can only glimpse at through small clues as things emerge.
And to this point, my final question is, it's a two-parter really about historians and journalists. Mm-hmm. You write in your book that that the historians mainly serve now to verify the provenance of documents, but that many still write from the desk drawer in hopes that things will change in the future. How are historians surviving in China now? Also, as a journalist, how difficult is it to report on China remotely? What are some of the obstacles you face?
Mm-hmm. So I think historians, in my book, I talked about how a lot of them face a lot of pressure. Obviously, it sort of depends on what you do. So if the kind of research you engage in is more directly related to the party, like you study the Mao era, you study party internal politics, you study sort of things that the party is concerned about. You study sensitive periods in recent history, which the party is not comfortable with being discussed too openly. That gets your attention, and that potentially gets you into trouble. You study earlier, you know, dynasties, you know, things that are more remote from the party, they care a bit less. You're not completely free from party scrutiny, because some things you uncover or some things you argue about previous dynasties could have impact on the official narrative of Chinese history as the party wishes it to be understood. So they also want to make sure there's consistency in the official narrative about ancient Chinese history. But the scrutiny on that is far less. What really gets them concerned is if you start digging up things about, you know, the Cultural Revolution or the Great Famine of 59 to 61, or the anti-righteous campaign, which is this massive purge that Mao Zedong directed in the late 50s. Things that, you know, could damage the party's reputation, the party cares a lot about and scrutinizes much more closely. Writing for the Deshore, perhaps you explain to viewers, you know, writing for Deshore essentially means you would still do your research, but then you hold it back. You don't publish it because, you know, if you publish it, the editors will say, no, we can't publish this. This is too sensitive. Or if you somehow manage to get it printed, you get into trouble because officials come looking for you. So they just hold back this stuff, or they circulate it privately. Ian has a book coming out that talks about this phenomenon. You know, people circulate some misstep publications, especially mm-hmm. about things like the Cultural Revolution, which things you could never publicly discuss in a critical way. You circulate among friends and fellow academics who you know are interested in these things. So that's this. They keep the craft going, but in much more subtle and, you know, ways that protect themselves. Pivoting to journalism, I think there's a close overlap here, because access to information has been increasingly restricted under Xi Jinping. As we saw, especially in recent years, national security is now front and center of everything in terms of policymaking and in terms of assessing risk to the party. Just this year, we had a counter-espionage law coming into effect, which sort of, you know, is broadly and vaguely worded enough that people are worried that all sorts of things could be considered a threat to national security. Information, data, statistics that once upon a time you would not feel like is of any significant risk of being considered a threat to regime stability. Now it's like, oh, okay, food, you know, food prices, hog population of, like, you know, the livestock population in China, things that, you know, once upon a time, you just think you need to know this stuff for investing, you know, betting on Chinese food supplies and markets, but now it's potentially seen as information that could be prejudicial to China's food security.
Right.
When you have, when this sort of mentality comes, kicks into action, officials start locking down all this information. The most dramatic example recently is when they stopped publishing, you know, the youth unemployment numbers after, you know, many months of bad figures. So they see this thing as the desire to control the narrative is extended to very tight control of information, and that directly affects the ability of journalists to write about China, to learn about China, because we aren't getting access from insiders. It's very difficult to make contacts for people on the inside, if at all possible nowadays. And so we rely on open source material, and even that is becoming more difficult because they're locking down anything that they believe could portray them in a bad light or give away certain information about themselves they don't wish to be public. And also with a bunch of journalists like myself who are no longer able to work in China, whether through visa non-renewal or expulsions, you're not on the ground. You can't talk to people face to face. That affects your ability to get, you know, the sort of humanistic color, you know, the tactile lived experience of being in China, experiencing government policies firsthand, you know, interacting with people, understanding how they feel and, you know, how they react to situations around them. You lose the ability to do this sort of reporting. And that, I think, affects the quality of the work you can do. But we try to get around it. You know, we try to talk to people virtually. We try to triangulate information for as many open source materials as possible. But it's difficult. It's getting more challenging. But I think the more difficult it is, the more harder we have to try, because China is just too important. You know, we have to do our best to try to understand this country.
Sure.
Well, we want to eventually bring in some audience questions, but let me hit you up with a couple of really quick questions. I want you to keep your answers super short.
Mm-hmm.
One is, do you get the sense that Xi Jinping is suffering from an information deficit? If you look at the COVID lockdown, which probably went on for at least a year or two long, made sense at first, but then just went on and on, led to protests and so on and so forth. These are signs perhaps of a leader who has cracked down and got the country so firmly under control that nobody dares bring bad news to him. And maybe it's the same with the economy. The economy is slowing. Youth unemployment is at record highs. And yet there are no real reforms that are being pushed to that would address these kind of issues. Again, maybe signs of a leader who is too insulated from reality, who has too many yes men around him. Is that your sense? This is certainly a dominant view in this country, and I wonder what your sense is. Do you think, or is that too simplistic?
I think there's element of that, definitely. When you look at the kind of people he's surrounded himself with, most recently at the 2022 Party Congress, the Politburo, 24 people, excluding himself, his 23 colleagues in the Politburo are all more or less his people. And these people who have connections with him through their early careers or work together in the more recent years in the senior leadership. These people are his men. He trusts them. He trusts them to bind. I mean, essentially, these people bind to his vision. So by nature of them being in that position, being allowed to be in that position by Xi, you already are create this sort of groupthink situation. You're already people who subscribe to his vision, who want to support his vision, and do your best in delivering on his priorities. So you're less likely to get within this elite circle, sort of dissenting views, or at least views that are so far removed or distant from the leader's priorities that you actually would pose like a serious challenge or seriously question his priorities or seriously question his judgment. So I think the nature of the politics now, which is completely restructured around Xi Jinping, sort of makes it more difficult to have genuine or like rigorous policy debate. That might still happen in the further you get away from the inner circle, but when you have engineered a climate of fear, as Xi Jinping does through anti-corruption campaigns and punishment of, you know, officials who are deemed negligent or indolent, you also make it more difficult for people to really surface, you know, their true thinking on certain issues. You sort of second guess what he wants, and you bring to him ideas and proposals that you think he would like, or he would more likely be would likely accept. And I think that definitely affects the quality of decision making. He may not be presented with the full gamut of information that will allow him to come to a more informed considered decision. And I think we are seeing the after effects. We've seen policy whiplash, you know, zero COVID, suddenly pivoting to more or less, you know, unwinding all these restrictions almost overnight. This sort of thing, I think, is a reflection of the sort of lack of quality, perhaps, guidance. And I think also his insistence on his priorities. When Xi Jinping gives instructions, it's often based on our reporting, like he gives vague sort of macro level instructions, which then people are sort of expected to divine into practical decisions and practical policies. Mm-hmm. And then if you present it to them and it's like, he doesn't like certain proposals you have, then he'll circle on them and like say, no, do better than that. So he doesn't prescribe overly, but at the same time, you know, the environment is created is one where people can't really present genuine alternatives. I think they still have to try to basically shape solutions and policy proposals to his what they think is his liking. And I think that's a significant factor in why we're seeing these problems today in terms of governance.
Pardon me, gentlemen. I just want to make a quick announcement to our viewers. Please start sending in your questions for Chun Han and Ian. They'll get to them shortly. Ian, you have time for a few more questions as well, though, until they start.
Okay, yeah. No, I mean, by the same token, when in the foreign policy field, one senses that the government has pursued a lot of self-defeating policies. It's been extremely strident over the past 5 or 10 years with Chinese diplomats in foreign countries basically criticizing their hosts, China's policies. It's created this backlash in Southeast Asia, where you are, where many countries that were once maybe somewhat agnostic toward China or even somewhat positive, or that they've become much more almost pro-US, or at least working to the US, or hoping the US can sort of help out in ways that wasn't perhaps necessary or the case maybe 5 or 10 years ago. Do you think this is also a sign of Xi not quite getting the message or the feedback that's necessary? And in the future, I guess for foreigners, people in foreign countries, do you see China continuing to pursue this kind of hardline policy, or do you think it will change and modify it?
I think there has been a slight adjustment in this sort of strong, abrasive foreign policy that we've seen under Xi Jinping. In 2021, he gave this instruction at a Politburo meeting where he says, you want people to try to create a more lovable China, which, you know, sounds a bit weird coming in this context where China is quite disliked, especially in advanced economies around the world, according to Pew surveys from the last few years. But I think there's definitely an element of him trying to impose this, well, his China dream. I'll take a step back here. China dream is essentially build this idea that fundamentally make China great again. You know, that's in the short, long and short of it. And it involves making China a militarily strong, economically powerful, and globally respected country. And in his words, it's sort of like 平视世界. So China can look in the world in the eye. You know, we've arrived, you know, we deserve to be here, respect us. And when that is sort of this very basic demand, he insists, right, is non-negotiable. China cannot play second fiddle to anybody. China should not be deferential to anybody. It is a great power and should act as such and should be treated as such. And that sort of sets this baseline, you know, and officials, diplomats have to deliver on this. It's not something they can, you know, wish away. Xi Jinping will never compromise on this core demand. So I think the basic instinct in trying to satisfy this objective that Xi has set for everybody, including himself, makes it very difficult to back away from some of the more strident positions they have taken, because they'll be seen as compromise and concessions, having staked them so forcefully in previous years. It makes it incumbent on any official to respond forcefully to anything that could be perceived domestically as a provocation from foreign countries. Mm-hmm. So, you know, in some cases where in America, for example, US government introduces a new policy to perhaps like restrict Chinese ability to get access to high-end technology, the Chinese have no choice but to respond in kind, or respond as forcefully as they can. Because anything less, you know, you're sort of letting yourself down. You're betraying this idea that you are, that Xi Jinping and his administration is a strong defender of Chinese interests and would, you know, take no slight against their dignity. So I think when you've set this bar of expectation from the public in terms of how you should engage with the rest of the world and maintain Chinese national dignity, it becomes more difficult to rein in some of these more quote-unquote wolfish instincts, you know, with reference to the wolf war diplomacy. But there is, I think there are some attempts to dial down some of the more abrasive methods that some diplomats have used, but I think the core instinct remains the same. Right. And it's very hard to see that changing, given that nationalism arguably has become a much more important pillar which the party uses to support its own rule.
I guess my final question I just wanted to ask you, and this is sort of a dumb question or the real basic question, perhaps. He's now got a third term. Term limits have been relaxed. Is he going to just stay in office and die in office or something like that? He's going to take a fourth term, a fifth term, depending on how his health is. Or do you think he'll do kind of like what Deng Xiaoping did and other leaders, where they put somebody else in the front and they say, okay, you run the thing. I'll be still there behind the scenes like a puppet master, but I will no longer be general secretary, president, et cetera, et cetera. How do you see that? Is he able to do that, or does he stay in the saddle until the end?
That's a very difficult question to answer. In fact, I devoted an entire chapter to this in the book. And in fact, if you read the book, you realize that I try not to make any predictions because I think it's So I think what I try to do in the book is to give frameworks to help people understand how China has dealt with succession in the past, and therefore the kind of methods, the kind of approach and understanding that Xi brings to the table when he has to decide succession. And what you described just now, I think, are all possibilities. You cannot rule any of them out because only he truly knows how he wants to tackle this question. You could do a Deng thing, which is essentially you slowly step back from the front lines. You give more and more, delegate more and more responsibilities to your chosen successor. But as Xi Jinping understands very well, is that you could make the wrong choice. Mao Zedong made, you know, he purged two designated successors. Deng Xiaoping also purged two of his proteges. So you could decide, okay, I like this guy. I think he could do the job. And end up, as you test him, you give him more responsibilities, you realize actually he's not up to it. And then you replace him. So this is one possibility. Another possibility is that Xi Jinping may come to a point where he doesn't feel comfortable handing over power because he just can't find the right guy. To take a step back at this moment, my belief is that Xi Jinping wants to do succession right, because if you don't do succession right, you don't hand over to the guy who can defend your legacy, all you've achieved in your lifetime as leader will come to naught, because either the successor is weak and doesn't hold on to power long enough to defend your legacy, it all falls apart, or you fail to hand over, you die in office without having picked a successor, there's a power struggle, and someone that you did not like to be in power actually manages to take, you know, the throne. So Xi Jinping, in terms of, you know, we know from his public rhetoric that he understands the gravity of the succession issue. He wants to make sure the Communist Party rule is perpetuated for as long as possible. And that comes down to his ability to make sure he handles the next leadership transition right. There are many ways to do it. I don't know exactly how he might do it, but I think more likely than not, he wants to be able to test the next guy, whether it's in terms of handing over day-to-day responsibilities, giving him certain positions, or Xi Jinping himself stepping back like Deng, maybe taking like a titular title like chairman of the party while the new general secretary actually runs the party. That's possible. But I think he does want to make sure he gets the choice of his next leader right. And he wants to be around to correct this mistake if it turns out he chose the wrong person.
Yeah, okay. We've got a couple of questions coming in. We've got two by Albert Zaleski Benbasa. One, I think I could just answer. He says that there have been a rash of library book bans in the United States. Do these stories get media coverage in China? I would say the answer to that is they do not, probably, right? But the other question is, can you both talk about China's current relationship with Russia? What is the best response from Western leaders? So what do you think, Chun-Han? What is China's relationship? I mean, he sort of embraced Putin on the eve of the Ukraine war, either caught unaware of it or not. Either one, not exactly a great look for Xi. Why does he embrace Russia? I mean, Russia isn't exactly an A-list country anymore.
Yeah. So to give a bit of historical context, China and Russia are not best of friends, not in, you know, history, not even today. I think it's best to see the lens of China-Russia relations through this idea of sort of marriage of convenience. Because if not, you don't have to go too far back to find very clear signs of discord between China and Russia. You know, we had border skirmishes within living memory between Soviet Union and China, where people were killed. You know, there were border the clashes between troops between the two countries. The Sino-Soviet split in the 50s and 60s. There was also another famous episode. So it's not as if these two countries are like natural brethren. They share a very long land border. So that in itself is always a cause of tension. There's always going to be a problem when, you know, you are squabbling over territory and historical grievances. But I think reason why there's such a tight relationship between Russia and China today, partly I think can be explained by this personal sort of relationship between Putin and Xi. I think both of them in some ways, but are not exactly similar. I think there are key differences between the two men, but in terms of leaders at that level of power, people at that, you know, world leaders of that stature, commanding a military and economy of that scale, these two people are the most alike. I think there's definitely a degree of affinity between them, but also in terms of strategic positioning, the China has recognized the US as the key threat to its ambitions. And there's not exactly a long list of choices in terms of strategic partners that China can find to give more weight to its, you know, efforts to try to defend against what it perceives to be American encirclement. So Russia becomes this arguably the most important strategic partner in this regard. In terms of pushing back against Western pressure, there is no other major world power of sufficient clout and influence and economic, you know, strength to complement China's efforts to resist the West and, you know, assert its own position in global affairs. So I think that is the dynamic that we have to understand.
Yeah, okay, that's great. Our final question before we end it, we got a good question from Peter Landy. What do you think is the significance of Xi not attending the G20? And maybe as a sort of broader context to this question, I could just add, there have been some signs of sort of strange behavior, perhaps, or things coming out of the leadership, the head of the People's Liberation Army's Rocket Division or Rocket Corps, whatever the exact name is, that the two top leaders were purged recently after having been relatively recently appointed by Xi Jinping, which implies some sort of tumult at the top of the military. Are there signs of problems in Xi's rule that perhaps, and there was a very speculative article in Nikkei a couple of days ago that Xi was upgraded by senior leaders. That seems very unlikely. But do you think there's anything going on, or are we just overinterpreting things based on very fragmentary knowledge?
I think I would hew to the latter, which is we have so little understanding of what truly goes on behind the scenes at the top levels of power. We, insofar as journalists and academics have access, is often to people lower down the food chain, and we can get a sense of how people at that level are feeling. But the true machinations in the true inner circle, the Politburo, the Standing Committee, which is just seven people, and she's, you know, perhaps close advisors, that we cannot really get into. I think it's very hard for us to have any clear insight. Even if we do get slivers of information coming out from that circle, it's going to be partial. It's going to be perhaps biased because, you know, people don't leak unless there's a reason to. So we have to understand that we can never get a complete picture as to how the leadership thinks. We can only guess at it and try to triangulate based on what we can prove to be true. Having said that, so I think there are signs that things are not going that well. In terms of policy responses to the economic situation, we can tell that the leadership is struggling to find ways to, you know, rejuvenate the economy, repair investor confidence and consumer confidence. And the sort of personnel changes you mentioned, I think there is definitely a purge going on in the military. We've heard, you know, we're not being able to confirm some of these things, but there's definitely a lot of chatter among, you know, along the grapevine that there is some sort of purge going on in the upper ranks of the PLA. We also saw Qin Gang, the foreign minister, disappear for a month before being removed as foreign minister. So there are definitely things going on behind the scenes that we're not fully aware of the reasoning behind them. But I wouldn't go so far to say that that definitely is proof of some sort of trouble for Xi Jinping. His position, as far as we can ascertain, seems to be relatively secure. Obviously, that can change as events evolve. But I think some of these things, we tend to latch onto them and project what we hope to be happening rather than what we know to be happening. So that's the risk. And I think it's best to avoid extrapolating too much into the slivers of evidence that we can find.
I think that's wise. Great advice. The book is Party of One, The Rise of Xi Jinping and China's Superpower Future. Chun-Han and Ian, thank you so much for this really informative and quite riveting hour.
Yeah, thanks a lot.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, everybody, for watching. Have a great weekend.
Thanks, everyone.
Take care, everyone.
Thank you.
Yeah.